Camino de Santiago, the Way of St. James, called the longest road of Europe, which, according to Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, has shaped Europe, continues to attract every year hundreds of thousands of travelers and pilgrims from all over the world, including even the footballers of the Spanish national football team who visit Santiago de Compostela before each international tournament. What Camino de Santiago is could be experienced by students from six countries: Spain, Poland, Italy, Estonia, France and Denmark, taking part in Comenius' project, the St. James Way Cultural European Itinerary. During half-year preparation for the Camino Challenge, we walked dozens of kilometers across Hodges County during our preparation walks. We participated in extra history, culture and art classes related to Iberian Peninsula. More than 300 hours of voluntary work of our teachers were spent to prepare and organize the project, to create so-called products of our activities, including reports, films, interviews and presentations, thousands of pictures and dozens of hours of film shots. At the beginning of June 2012, a live adventure for a group of 15 students of Rataje Junior High School started. For most of them, it was the first travel abroad, the first flight, and the first longer time away from home. After 3 hours of flight from Berlin to Madrid, we landed in modern Barajas Airport, the second largest European airport in terms of passenger turnover. After a short welcome with the Italian and Dutch students, we took a bus from Madrid to Astorga, a town of picturesque Gaudi buildings, pilgrimage museum and Albergue de Pellegrinos, the pilgrim's shelter, Siervas de Maria, with a statue of a medieval pilgrim in front. The ascetic shared accommodation, absolute night silence, was a shocking experience for some of us. Having left our own homes behind, we suddenly had to deal alone with our weaknesses, homesickness, and the physical effort. At 6 o'clock early in the morning, we set off for the first stage of our journey. In the village of Fonsaveron, at the altitude of 1,440 meters above the sea level, we are welcomed by bitter cold and dense fog. A beautiful tiny settlement, with its stone houses falling apart, transferred us into the medieval times. Here, in the 12th century, an hermit Gauselmo set up a hospital for pilgrims, which is now a pilgrim shelter, a hospice and a church. Fonsaveron was located on the one and only medieval route into the Bierzo Mountains, where gold used to be dug out. So Saint Francesco himself must have probably been here during his pilgrimage to Santiago. By the entrance of the settlement there is a wooden cross with a request written in several languages not to put stones here. Why such a strange request? We learned that in the following village. Leaving Fonsaveron, we were sorry that the fog kept secret the natural beauty of the surrounding valleys and mountains. Probably every traveler coming from a city would ask himself how one can live in such severe conditions away from the comfort of civilization. Maybe the answer would come if we are transferred into the medieval times to experience the Franciscans' delight over the beauty of nature, rejecting personal possessions in favor of aestheticism and joy of the tiny things we create. The world of internet and the world of abundance deprived our senses of experiencing the real world and focused us on the virtual world. The rush for wealth in the era of consumption and selling, creating a greedy, money and fashion-oriented man. But the simplicity of the Camino allows us to bring back the right relations between people, to reflect what should really be important in life: possessions or spiritual development, self-admiration or the needs of the others. 2 kilometers up the hill we found Cruz de Ferro, a 5 meter tall oak post with an iron cross at the top, which the name derives from, and which became one of the symbols of the Camino. According to a tradition, pilgrims from all over the world leave stones here, which they had carried from home. The pile of stones symbolizes the dualism of the world, Leaving the stone, we leave the worries, sorrows, troubles, and we clear our minds of depressions and start to look ahead into the future with a new hope. We are reborn and carry our travel on with new resolutions. For the travelers, it does not really matter whether, as the legend says, the place was originally an altar of the Roman god Mercury, or it was erected by the Celts or by the noble Gaucelmo. Everybody puts their stones under the cross of redemption and meditates upon their own wishes. Not far from the cross, a hermitage, Ermita de Santiago, was built in 1982 to commemorate the holy year. Nearby there is also a stone sun clock. One of the strangest places on the Camino is Manjarín, a place of two residents. It is a refugio, a shelter, run by a man dressed in a Templar gown, calling himself Thomas. It is a shelter with no electricity, no hot water, but only with medieval sewer. After a couple of kilometers, we rest in El Acebo. We look at the rustic beauty of stone houses and slated roofs. The village seems deserted, even with no animals in the streets. On the outskirts of the village, our attention is drawn to a monument of a German cyclist who died suddenly on the way. Finally, we approach the end of our journey that day. Crossing a Roman bridge over the river Meruelo, we enter Molina Seca, inhabited by a population of only 800 people. Tired after the long walk, we seek rest in the natural spa of the cold currents of the river Meruelo. What a relief for tired and sore feet. Above the river, in Puenta Romano restaurant, we enjoy the tidbits of Galician cuisine, sweet mutton and jamón, a kind of Spanish ham. Even plain bread and water tastes like sophisticated meals. We start the second stage of our journey in Trabadeo, in the valley of river Valcarce, and finish in the little medieval settlement El Cebreiro, located on the border of Galicia and Castilla-León region. How different from the previous stage this one is! Heading towards El Cebreiro, at the altitude of 1,300 meters above the sea level, we walk along roadsides, pass under monumental bridges over the river Valcarce. We pass tiny villages built of stone and look at small patches of field divided by stone walls. We walk through Vega de Valcarce, a little village set in the 9th century by the Saracens. From a distance we admire the ruins of Castillo de Saracín. In La Faba we pass a refugio built by Germans, with a sculpture of a pilgrim which, contrary to the one in Astorga, seems to be more tired. We move on, and a couple of kilometers further, we pass a stone which marks the border between Castilla-León and Galicia. Galicia is different from other regions. No heritage of Muslim culture is compensated with mountain views, as well as changeable weather and frequent rains. Approaching the end of the second stage of our journey, a tiny village El Cebreiro, we are more and more surprised. A couple of paillosa buildings, round stone dwellings with a thatched roof and Celtic music remind us of the old times when Celts actually lived in the region. The souvenir shop mostly sells witches, druids and demons. To feel the Celtic atmosphere, one should just sit down in the shade of paillosa house, drink coffee and taste Tarta de Santiago, the pilgrim's cake. The mysterious settlement is rich in history. The Holy Virgin Mary Church is known for a Eucharistic miracle recognized by the Vatican. One severe winter day in the year 1300, an unbelieving Benedictine priest was celebrating a Holy Mass. There were only two persons in the church, the priest and one peasant, Juan Santin, from the nearby village of Barza Mayor. During the Holy Mass, a miracle happened. The host was turned into flesh, and the wine into blood. The relics of the miracle, an ample with the miraculous blood and the 12th century chalice of the miracle, are still kept in the church. The chalice rim bears a Latin inscription. Hoc sacratur, quo cuntis vita parabatur. Eternal life for everybody. And around the base there are the Latin words. In nomine nostri Christi et Beate Mariae Virgine. In the name of our Lord Christ and the Holy Virgin Mary. And so the chalice of the miracle became known as the Galician Grail. In El Sobreiro, we met our Camino friend, a Pole from Germany, who, as he said himself, was spending the best vacation in his life. He cycled around 700 kilometers route from the French border to Fisterra. In the afternoon, we go to the famous monastery in Samos, on the river Oibio. The monastery is a mixture of styles, Gothic, Renaissance and Baroque. A real treasure of monastic architecture. The second floor houses Enrique Navarre's murals showing the history of the monastery and the life of its patron, Saint Benedict. The painter gave the historic characters the faces of the celebrities of his time. The Benedictine order is known for preserving the heritage of the ancient Rome and Greece and saving the Latin civilization. How was it possible? The Benedictines built monasteries on the regions of the former Roman Empire. Their monasteries were not only the places of prayer, but also the centers of science, theoretical and practical knowledge. Above the entrance to the monastery library, there is an inscription, Claustrum sine librario, sicut castrum sine armamentario. A monastery without a library is like a castle without armament. Our next shelter for two nights is in a little town of Portomarin, in Albergue Ferramenterio, with a beautiful view of Belesar, a water reservoir built in 1963. Portomarin is a Galician town in the province of Lugo, 385 meters above the sea level, on the river Rio Minho. When the river level is low, one can see the remnants of the old ports, which remembers the Roman times. San Pedro on the left bank and San Juan on the right bank. The reason to create an artificial water reservoir was floods troubling the local residents. The old city was moved stone by stone up a hill where today we can still admire interesting monuments of the past. Put apart and rebuilt was also the most precious monument of Portomarin, St. John's Church, originally built at the turn of the 12th and the 13th century. The rich decoration in the main portal resembles those in Compostela. The figure of Christ surrounded by 24 elders of the Book of Revelation. Portomarin is famous for Fiesta de Aguardiente, during which shows and contests of Galician cognac distillation is organized every year. Two local types are Aguardiente de Bagazzo, which has no color and contains about 50% of alcohol, and Aguardiente de Herbas, which is yellowish herbal liquor. The attachment to tradition is so strong here that a big Alguitarra distillery was built in the middle of the city square. After supper, we were invited to a concert of Celtic music organized especially for us in the central square of Portomarin. The present-day region of Portomarin used to be inhabited by Celtic nations, which is why Celtic clothes and souvenirs are common here. Galician music also has strong Celtic and Irish influence, with a distinctive sound of Galician bagpipes called gaita. An interesting fact is that there are three Galicias in Europe, one in Poland, one in Turkey, and one in Spain. How changeable the weather in Galicia can be, we have experienced during the third stage of our journey, walking around 20 kilometers from Sarria to Portomarin. The final kilometers we walked in heavy rain. Luckily, the pilgrim's shelter provided special clothes and shoe dryers. On that day, we walked across Galician hills, tiny villages and picturesque churches. Each precious piece of land here is used for farming. The tradition says to bury the dead very close to a church, and there is no much land left, so the cemeteries are vertical, not horizontal like they are in Poland. Our fourth stage of the journey into Galicia starts in Vilar de Donas, at a small one-nave, early 13th century Romanesque church of San Salvador, the Holy Savior. Located away from the main road, it attracts people with its aged appearance and wild vegetation covering the surrounding fence. Time seems to stop here. The only indication of the passing of time is lichen growing on the stone walls and the portico guarding the wooden entrance door with its iron fittings. The church, built on the cruciform plan with a semicircular apse, originally belonged to the nunnery, hence the name Donnes, and then to the Order of Saint Jacob. In the silence of the church, we admire the 14th century Gothic frescoes representing scenes from the Bible, pensive nuns, and tombs. Such frescoes are difficult to find, as Galician temples are rarely covered with plaster. The church is considered to be a unique treasure of Romanesque architecture. Sarcophagi of Galician knights killed in battles with the Moors can still be found in the church. Our guide proudly emphasized that Galicia was never conquered by the Muslims, except for the brief invasion of Santiago de Compostela. It is almost dinner time. In the town of Melide, we visited the famous Pulperia Ezequiel, where we try probably the best delicacy in Europe, the Galician octopus. Our students were shocked when a cook entered the room with a huge steaming octopus. The view was terrifying for some of us. Sprinkled with special pepper, the octopus was served on wooden plates with bread. The taste was delicious, unlike any delicacies of our cuisine. So travelers from all over the world come to Pulperia Ezequiel to taste this fine food. Galicia is known for its fine seafood, so the shops in neighborhood offer crab, shrimps, crayfish, and calamari instead of meats. We are approaching Santiago de Compostela. On the way we stop at Monte de Gozo, the Mount of Joy. What a surprise for us to find there the monument of John Paul II, twice a pilgrim to Santiago de Compostela. Not far away, there is the European Pilgrimage Center of John Paul II. The name of the mount is very precise. From its top, one can easily see Santiago with the cathedral glittering proudly in the center. Everybody is overjoyed to see that the end of our journey is near. When we enter Obradoiro Square, we meet travelers from all over the world, weary, tired, but happy to reach the end of their journey. All together we go to the Apostle's tomb, a moment of reflection in silver refectory in which the bones of the Apostle and his two companions, Theodore and Athanasius, are placed. There are so many travelers and pilgrims, and there are so many thoughts and private intentions whispered by the tombs, to change one's life or to thank for something important. In Obradorio Square, our students conducted some interesting interviews. Casual passersby talked about their camino, about what the journey was for them. Great stories of people from around the world make us humble and put our lives into a new perspective. The Camino spirit stays with us. Suddenly, we meet our friend from Germany. We took photos to remember, we wished safe travel back home, and we felt the feeling of being united with all the other peregrinos. Early in the afternoon, we reach Fisterra after traveling along cliff coast of Costa della Muerte, the coast of death, and the Atlantic Ocean. Finally, the port of Fisterra, where we stopped in a picturesque restaurant, Osentolo Fisterra, with a nice view of the port. The restaurant is famous for seafood, which we had a chance to taste. After the meal, the organizers had prepared a concert of traditional Galician music accompanied by Pandereta Gallega, Galician tambourine. The town of Fisterra is also known for characteristic monuments. One of them is erected in the port to commemorate 2.5 million Galician citizens of the region forced to emigrate abroad in search of job between the years 1836 and 1980. A note on the monument says, Jebanos amoros gaenos espalados polo mundo. Galicians, take our love around the world. It reminds us about the situations of many European nations, especially the Polish nation, which experienced the same problems at the same time. The second monument, an anchor, is dedicated to those who died on Costa de Muerte. The dangerous cliffs and frequent storms caused many sea catastrophes, including the biggest ecological catastrophe in Spain. In 2002, an oil tanker MT Prestige sank here and about 5,000 tons of oil got into the water. Unfortunately, we had no time to visit another place of great interest, a unique cemetery designed by architect Cesar Portela. On a hillside, he located granite blocks representing a modern form of tombs, apotheosis of the feeling of rest, silence, and the unity of man and nature. After the sunset, we walk along the Cabo of Finisterra, one of the most forward west headlands of Spain. By the ancient Romans, the place was considered to be the end of the world, hence its name, which is a combination of two words, finis and terra, the end and the land. It is the very last stage of the Camino for the pilgrims walking to Santiago. Light sea breeze, clouded sky, and the noise of the waves breaking against the shore rocks forms a sense of awe and reverie. According to tradition, after coming to Cape Finisterra, pilgrims burn in the fire unneeded things or throw them into the sea. It is a symbolic cleansing with strong resolutions to start a new life. Therefore, without telling us her resolutions, Sandra threw her shoes into the ocean too. We say goodbye to the beautiful Galicia, a place which will remain in our memory as a forever green land with a rich and complex history. Its inhabitants enchanted us with their hospitality, simplicity, and sincerity. We've learned a piece of European heritage, which still teaches us respect for the past. We understand now why a wooden walking stick with a conch of Saint Jacob is more suitable on the way than Nordic walking sticks. We've learned to accept even those ascetic albergues, night silence from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. and modest meals. We are not even afraid of the Galician witches, magas, and physical limitations due to the hardships of our walking. As a souvenir, we obtained two certificates, one from the mayor of Fisterra, a special certificate of Cabo Fisterra with a sentence of Portuguese writer Luís Vaz de Camões, Onde a terra se abaca e o mar começa, where the land ends and the sea begins. The other one is a unique certificate by the Convention of Franciscan Order issued only once in 100 years. This was to commemorate the pilgrimage of Saint Francis of Assisi to Santiago, which took place in the year 1214. Our pilgrimage took place exactly 800 years after this event. Paraphrasing the sentence, we can say, where the Camino ends, a new life begins. And so we say goodbye to our dear friends from Italy, Spain, France, Denmark, and Estonia. Buen Camino!